when I see a blank wall at a space, I'm thinking, oh my goodness, yeah, I would love to put on, I shouldn't say this, the black hoodie and go do it at night time. That would be very exciting. Yes, but I won't.
I didn't think my perception of street art could have changed so much in the space of a few weeks. I have always noticed graffiti and murals present anywhere I go, and most of the time I would ask myself why the artist decided to draw a specific twirl in that exact location. What the meaning and feelings were behind sneaking out at nighttime to create. But I had always just assumed that any act of rebelliousness in the streets had been the product of a young mind. During April 2019, street art festival Noirt Aberdeen invited Portuguese team Lasa 65 to host a graffiti and street art workshop for those over 65 years of age.
So of course when he'd heard about this, he took my attention to, now you'll have to get involved. What? You know, I'm not particularly artistic, but I'll have a go, which is fine. So then, a few of us met down here. We were then, Angela, as you know, Angela Joss, she explained basically what the whole thing was about. And we had to go to the college and find out how to make stencils. And we were going to be doing graffiti. Wow, woo! So I think most people, when you say graffiti, they think it's some lunatic being let loose with a spray can, just doing anything. They then introduced us to the finer things of making stencils. And we had to go to college, I think, how many days? 3-4 days? And that was really quite fascinating in its own, because you think, right, okay, it's fine, we just cut it out, you know? And then you lift it up and you realise it falls through. So I think it was Duarte showed us how to make bridges. And there was a great wail every so often, no, I've lost my bridge. It was wonderful. And it's certainly, again, you were looking at a group of older people who were really learning a lot of new skills. My God, did they ever take to it very quickly and very skillfully. I was impressed. So then we walked down to the Adelphi and we were shown this wall that we had to cover. And I think all of us went, what? You know? We all had to have our tag, which was great. And all the tags are still there, which was even better. We then had to do a word and also a picture, if I can recollect properly. And then we were all let loose with spray cans and with guidance, which helped. And there you have, within 5 days, a group of older people who knew nothing about either graffiti or working with spray cans are making stencils, and they did that wall. That was impressive. And what is impressive, the people who stop and speak to you. Now, these are talking points that are great. There's involvement, there's interaction with the public, and that is what you want. So maybe those who own old folks' homes, maybe if they look beyond, okay, they think if you're providing food and a bed and caring, whatever that's interpreted as, take a walk down, because you know something, that would have far more lasting effect on people than sitting watching television all day.
The Aberdeen workshop resulted differently because a city-wide call for those over 65 was issued. Lata 65 originally works along care homes and other institutions so as to provide a cheerful experience for those who aren't as lucky as to maintain their independence. Lata 65 is an opportunity to socialize and keep the brain active through creativity, which are two of the main things people with dementia can do in order to battle the disease day to day. People over 65 have a higher risk of getting dementia, and although there are some medicines that can help for a little while, there is no exact cure for it. Alzheimer's Research UK states that almost 600 people develop dementia every day, and even though the experience varies from individual to individual, it is clear that being among other people is extremely important for those who suffer from it. The number of people living with dementia in care homes and nursing homes is pretty high. Since the disease can become quite tasking, very often family and friends see themselves needing to part ways with their elders, sending them to what they believe is better care. Along with the loneliness and confusion that come with the diagnosis, patients also show symptoms of anxiety, depression, societal withdrawal, and decreased self-confidence. Feeling a sense of belonging is crucial, and artsy workshops like Lata 65 can provide a loving environment and a boost of self-worth for those who most need it.
Yo no hago nada, casi nada. Es mucho de esto, es la forma como trabajamos. Y en todos los proyectos hacemos este, pero Lata es especial y siempre será. Que ese es el proyecto que sé que voy a dar todo para que sea lo mejor posible, porque sé que les estoy dando una experiencia única, pero ellos a mí también. Y no es una cosa de, sí, yo estoy siendo simpática contigo, porque no pasa eso. Y a mí me encanta cuando veo que están haciendo cosas, y a mí me encanta. Porque ese es el objetivo principal del proyecto. Teníamos claro que lo íbamos a hacer y nos respondían que no iban a gastar más dinero con ancianos, que ellos ya han vivido demasiado y ya no necesitan de vivir. Y tú te piensas, vale, yo no quiero vivir en una sociedad así. Y eso es lo que más me asusta y es el tema, porque siempre estoy hablando de esto. Es un poco difícil de explicar la transformación que puedes en tan pocas horas. Se puede percibir en los ancianos que hacen Lata 65 y que no es un investimento nada de especial, pero yo cuando sea anciana quiero sentir eso, quiero tener esas experiencias y esas oportunidades. Yo no quiero que me digan, ya has vivido mucho, puedes morirte. Es horrible eso. Entonces es un poco de trabajar por ellos y por mí. Porque yo llegaré a su edad, si todo va bien, llegaré. Y quiero que mi vida sea un poco distinta de cosas que he visto, horribles. De formas de sentir muy tristes que he visto en los workshops. Entonces tienes que continuar haciendo, intentando hacerlo. Por ejemplo, ahora es totalmente imposible hacerlo porque no nos dejan trabajar con ancianos. Es una cosa que me preocupa un montón y por eso también hemos desenvolvido otro proyecto que es de las herramientas de la cuarentena, el Quarantine Workbook, que también tenés ahí, porque nos preocupó mucho esto de, vale, ahora se van a quedar en casa, ¿qué van a hacer? Tenemos que transmitirles algo, de darles actividades para que puedan hacer y pasar su tiempo. Y es un poco de no parar de pensar en cómo puedes sensibilizar, cómo trabajamos con personas que tienen discapacidades o que son invisuales, que nos llegan de silla de ruedas, pero también personas que simplemente no saben escribir y que tienes o que están con una gigante depresión, que es un grande porcentaje de las personas que nos llegan. Y la verdad es que se trabajan con toda la gente. Trabajamos por eso con grupos más pequeños de personas, ¿no? Normalmente un máximo de 15 personas, porque a pesar de que nosotros estamos solamente ahí para conducir el proyecto, el workshop, la verdad es que desde el primer momento, y es siempre muy, es un proceso de muchísima ansiedad antes de empezar el proyecto, porque nunca sabes cuál es el grupo que vas a encontrar, cuáles son sus dificultades, que yo creo que cada persona es un proyecto personal y que tienes que entender cuando llegas a la clase cuáles son sus dificultades. Y después pensar dentro de lo que es la dinámica del workshop y las misiones que tienes para ellos, los desafíos, ver cómo se pueden adaptar a cada uno de ellos. Hay cosas que podemos hacer, hay proyectos que no podemos hacerlo, pero siempre poniendo siempre una cosa muy clara. Tienes que estar aquí y compartir con nosotros este momento, aceptar los desafíos, y eso es a lo mejor la parte más difícil y la que tarda más tiempo. Yo creo que en Aberdeen no hemos tenido esto, porque como era un proyecto abierto a quien quería venir, todos querían estar ahí. Entonces esa resistencia inicial de ya no sé, así, no sé por qué estoy aquí, solo me apetece morir, no sé qué, eso en Aberdeen no pasó. Pero nos pasa un montón de veces cuando vas a una institución de ancianos en que solamente los directores saben que vamos ahí, o a lo mejor les han explicado un poco lo que estaremos haciendo, pero no saben concretamente lo que estamos haciendo ahí. Entonces esos primeros 15, 30 minutos es que estás ahí partiendo piedra y entusiasmándoles por el trabajo, y después ya todo sigue su curso normal.
I've done a lot of things but couldn't problem solve because I didn't have enough knowledge. So doing the stencil allows me to add to a piece of art. So for instance, if I had this hat and I wanted to put something on it, I could do a stencil now. It doesn't have to be freehand. So putting that together with the other skills that I've learned over the years, I can do different things, and I do have a couple of projects going that I might not have done. I enjoyed every single part from the beginning to the end. I absolutely loved the team that was teaching us. I have to admit, the Adelphi Tunnel was probably the best part, because I thought we would go down and we'd be told, you can spray this little bit and do this and do that, but they didn't. They just gave us the cans and said, go for it, which was really exciting. It was a fantastic introduction to graffiti painting. It would be really good to find a way to reach the people that are isolated and bring them back into the community. And I think it would change lots of things. Attitudes, even health. You know, give them something else to work towards. It just gives you a whole new perspective on life and opens everything up for you. Absolutely, I think it would make a huge difference. And it might make a difference to the NHS too, because it's very therapeutic. I think if the generations work together, it could be very exciting, because the older people are bringing a lot of knowledge and the younger people are bringing a lot of energy and new ideas. And I think right down to the people in the care homes, and even the ones that can't get outside, is taking it to them. You don't have to hand them a spray can, but you can use the concept of graffiti, and I think it would be really good. I would like to see it go into the homes, even doing a little bit of painting in the gardens, where they would come outside in the summer and sit in the chairs or sit in their wheelchairs and know that that's their little bit that they've done. Possibly the second day, a couple of us had talked about this would be really good to keep it going, and that was before we did the Adelphi Tunnel. So the group got together, and Angela Joyce very kindly offered to take over the group and manage it. So we've done a lot of projects, and they're now doing words on windows and Doric. For me, I want to expand to other things, other media, and have the time to go and experiment. So I've kind of moved away from that just now.
the graffiti anarchists came to us because we host two of their nights, which is basically one is a Doric speaking night and the other one is an over 50s, only performers over 50s can go on the stage. Mm-hmm. It's the Not Quite Dead Poet Society, so that's what they're called, and they do that, and through that and through the people that run that, through the Aberdeen Council, they came and they said, can we basically graffiti outside your premises, which was good because other idiots had already graffitied it, so it was a chance for us to cover it. And they tend not to go after stuff that's already been graffitied, although they're starting to do that as well now. Me and our premises is just getting tagged rotten just now, and we can't catch them. But we will keep our youngsters being stupid. I don't know why they do it. Private property, if we get them, we'll make them pay. One of the girls said, oh, we can do a better job of that then. Could we paint it? And they just come back and graffiti it again. But they haven't touched that. It's been up for over a month now, and so far they haven't touched anything.
That maybe requires a bit of confidence to stand up to people and just say, no, we are going to be doing this, you know? Or, you know, if somebody laughs at something, well, fine, let them laugh, you know? Just have the confidence to go on and do it. One of the things that was brought up in terms of his working with Aberdeen Drugs Action, ADA, and you know, a lot of their clients, for want of a better word, or people they support and help, maybe wouldn't want to be working with us, but were quite happy to give their ideas. Now that's good. That's a wee step, it's a start. Maybe if we do another project, they might say, yeah, I'll come and do some spraying with you. I don't know. As it is, we're picking up. People are now getting in touch with us to say, right, I've got this wall here, and maybe, you know, what do you think? And it's diverse. We've got a range of projects in the pipeline, and I think that's wonderful.
Whether everlasting or always changing, graffiti and street art impact not only our cities, but our communities too. Graffiti, born as an act to reclaim public spaces, remains anti-constitutional, frowned upon and punishable. But it also presents a creative outlet against prejudice and established power. While there's quite a divide between subversive graffiti and commercialized street art, the existence and acceptance of the latter allows people like the graffiti anarchists to have a go at building bridges between different groups in the community. Turns out that the key to a young and healthy subversive mind is the attitude of being ready to tackle anything thrown at you. And seeing how their mischievousness has come a long way since 2019, it is safe to assume that the graffiti granarchists are ready to keep on painting the town red.
Bring the art to the people if you can't bring the people to the art. It would definitely break down barriers.